So this is an exciting part of the day. This is, I've known Dr. Deering since I got here and consider him a real inspiration to me. He's that person who's had just not only an amazing clinical career and has touched many lives, but I'll tell you, as a person, I think he's one of the finest individuals I've met. He gives back in ways. It's really unbelievable. Dr. Deering received his undergraduate degree from Vanderbilt, did medical school at UAB in Birmingham, then did internship and residency at Walter Reed Army Medical Center, and his GYN oncology fellowship at the Uniformed Services University in DC. Spent time in Germany and Texas, and then ended up in 1991 back in Louisville and faculty at University of Louisville, and has been with Norton Cancer Institute for 24 years now, I think is the right number. He's a member of multiple societies, a fellow in the ACOG, a fellow in the American College of Surgeons. He's a member of Society of Clinical Oncology, and has had such a huge impact here in Louisville and in so many ways, not only just in the realm of GYN oncology, but in medicine in general, making sure that working with other people, you met Dr. Stevens earlier, but have really driven our program to be incredible. So Governor Nixon lectureship is really an honor for people that we think have had a huge indelible impact on our community and on medicine in general. And Dr. Deering is going to give our keynote speaker. So please help me in welcoming Dr. Deering.
Good afternoon. It's really a pleasure to be here. We have sound working. I've added some background music.
Will that disappear?
Content. It's been a long and winding road for myself and for the specialty of some question of GYN oncology. So I just want to talk a little bit about that today. Our objectives will be to review the history of GYN oncology as a subspecialty and discuss some of the recent advances in gynecologic oncology, and discuss some of the challenges facing our subspecialty today. It's never been a better time to be a gynecologic oncologist. I know from the other talks this morning that the progress that's been made in the last few years has been extraordinary and exciting. And gynecologic oncology is actually finally beginning to catch up a little bit. For just as a definition, our gynecologic oncology is a subspecialty dedicated to the care of women with gynecologic malignancies. We treat cancers of the ovary, fallopian tube, uterus, cervix, vagina, and vulva. And what's unique about our specialty is that we do both the surgery and then the medical care, so the chemotherapy. Very few other oncology specialties do you find physicians who are trained in both chemotherapy and surgery. And that's really what attracted me to the subspecialty in the first place, back when I was a resident a long time ago. Just to review the statistics, this is from a CA, a Journal for Clinicians, published in January of this year. You can see, you know, we still have around 14,000 cases of cervical cancer with over 4,000 deaths. Uterine cancer is one of the few cancers, unfortunately, that continues to have a rising incidence and mortality. You can see the numbers there. And unfortunately, the mortality expected from uterine cancer is projected to exceed that of ovarian cancer within the next year or so. And ovarian cancer, while not nearly as common, only about a third as many cases as endometrial, still has a very high mortality rate. For comparison, you can see the numbers for female breast cancer there, which is about 300,000. So GYN oncology, we have, if you include vagina and vulva, we probably have about 100,000 cases a year in the United States. Worldwide, cervical cancer has over 400,000 cases and a high mortality rate outside of places where modern care is available. So to talk about the history of GYN oncology, it really starts in 1898 with Dr. Ernst Wertheim. And you, those of you who are physicians may have heard of the Wertheim hysterectomy. Dr. Wertheim was a gynecologist in Vienna. He described the radical hysterectomy in 1898, 16 years after Halsted had described the radical mastectomy for breast cancer. And the goal was an en bloc removal of the cervix and uterus, including the surrounding tissues, or what we call the perimetrium. This, the picture you see there is actually a painting. The bald man on the left is Dr. Wertheim operating. In the anesthesia, general anesthesia was introduced around in the mid-1840s. And so between the late 1800s, hysterectomies were being performed, but the mortality rate for hysterectomies, just simple hysterectomies as we would call them now, was around 70%. I mean, can you imagine, would you sign a consent form for an operation that had a 70% mortality, not just morbidity? And most of that was from peritonitis. We didn't have antibiotics. They knew about antiseptic technique, but the techniques were not nearly as good as they were now. So this is Dr. Wertheim's original presentation, or for historical context, that was Hot Time in the Old Town Tonight from 1898. In his 1912 manuscript, which was published in the Journal of American Journal of OBGYN, that's the front page you see there, he reported on 500 cases of cervical, he reported on 500 cases of cervical, all right, make up your mind. I'm not touching the button. 500 cases of cervical cancer with about a 50% operability and 18.6% mortality. So even today, you know, that obviously wouldn't be acceptable, but compared to the 70% which had been reported previously, that was a vast improvement. And he attributed it to meticulous dissection and meticulous care, meticulous attention to antiseptic technique. He did not advocate the pelvic lymphadenectomy. He only advocated removal of enlarged lymph nodes. And he reported a 6.4% incidence of ureterovaginal fistula. Today, we still see ureterovaginal fistulas after radical hysterectomies, but the incidence is probably below 1%. 18.4% of all of his patients were alive and without disease at 5 years. So again, none of us today would accept that as a reasonable therapy for a disease, but that was far better than the 70% mortality that had been described previously. This is kind of a diagram of what the radical hysterectomy encompassed. So a typical hysterectomy would involve clamping and cutting right along the uterus and cervix and the upper vagina. And what made it a radical hysterectomy is that circle there in the middle that encompasses the surrounding tissue. And the problem is the ureters pass right through that at about the level of the cervix. So that requires a ureteral dissection. So despite Dr. Wertheim's favorable results, about the same time radiation therapy, well, the X-ray was discovered, and shortly thereafter, radiation began to be used for cancer treatment. And so between 1912 and 1950, really cervical cancer mainly was treated with radiation therapy, because at least the short-term morbidity was much lower. However, that was orthovoltage radiation, and there was the long-term complications included injury to bladder and rectum, vagina, small bowel. Because of the long-term complications, interest arose in the radical hysterectomy again, and Dr. Miggs, Joe Miggs, presented his data in 1951. He added a complete bilateral pelvic lymphadenectomy, advances in perioperative care, and now the availability of sulfonamide antibiotics dramatically reduced morbidity and mortality. In fact, he had no perioperative mortality.
To tell us we're too young. Too young.
This is Nat King Cole's Too Young from 1950. We'll hear about it tonight. Dr. Miggs presented his data. He found that in clinical stage one patients, 17.5% had positive nodes, but of the stage one patients, he reported nearly 90% five-year survival. And even in stage two, where nearly a third of the patients had positive nodes, still a 63% five-year survival. We do better today because we have better radiation therapy, and particularly with the advent of radiation sensitizing chemotherapy, those numbers are better. Although, you know, with stage one, even with stage one cervical cancer, 90% is a pretty good survival. We do better with stage two. So moving, so the radical hysterectomy is really the signature operation of the gynecologic oncologist. And in fact, you know, when I did my fellowship, the joke was that to be a gynecologic oncologist, you needed to know how to do a radical hysterectomy and administer Cytoxan and Adriamycin. In my case, they added the third year of the fellowship was added the year I started. So we had an extra year to learn those things. This is Dr. Papanicolaou. No discussion of GYN oncology would be complete without mentioning him. I'm sure you all know the father of the pap smear. He was a physician, but also had a PhD in zoology, and had the idea that he could correlate changes in vaginal cytology in the guinea pig with the estrus cycle. And then he started applying that to humans. So in 1928, he first reported that cancer cells could be identified on a vaginal smear. This is Paper Doll by the Mills Brothers from 1943. And in 1943, he published Diagnosis of Uterine Cancer by the Vaginal Smear. He's considered the father of cytopathology. His wife worked in the lab with him as a technician. She provided a vaginal smear every day for over 20 years. As did a number of other volunteers in the clinic. Dr. Papanicolaou. Dr. Papanicolaou recalled that he was reviewing these slides, and he saw a cancer cell, and he recalled that the first time he saw a cancer cell on a slide was the greatest thrill of his intellectual career. So by the 1950s, pap smears had become routine for screening for cervical cancer. And today we know that you can see here, regular cervical cytologic screening has been shown to reduce the incidence and mortality of cervical cancer by at least 80%. So I think it's pretty hard to say that about any other screening modality for any cancer. In addition, it's been estimated that the reduction of cervical cancer cases over the last three decades in the United States is somewhere between 100,000 and nearly 500,000. So you can imagine, you know, it's hard to say that any individual has made a greater impact on reducing cancer suffering than Dr. Papanikolaou. I didn't make any slides on HPV, but in the 1970s, I was in medical school, we started hearing about Dr. Harold Sirhausen from Heidelberg, who found this virus called HPV was expressed in most cervical cancers. And now we know that virtually all cervical cancers are caused by HPV. HPV can be detected by pap smears. It can also be detected by HPV DNA testing. Current recommendations for screening are a cytologic screen every 3 years or HPV testing every 5 years. Gardasil 9 was introduced or FDA approved in 2014, which covers the two viruses that cause genital warts, 6 and 11, plus 7 other viruses, that 16, 18, and 5 others that cause almost all 90% of cervical cancer. You know, if we could get everybody vaccinated, we could, again, have another order of magnitude of reduction of cervical cancer. Currently, only about 16% of women and 4% of men are vaccinated in the United States. So there's huge room for improvement there. All right, switching from cervical cancer and pap smear, this is a story that I've always found fascinating. Well, since my baby maybe most of you already know it. In 1956, Dr. Roy Hertz and Minchu Lee were working at the new National Cancer Institute. The clinical center had opened in 1953, and Dr. Hertz, who was an OBGYN and mainly an endocrinologist, but he admitted the first patient to the new clinical center. Dr. Lee was an immigrant from China. He was also an obstetrician. The story is that he took a position in Dr. Hertz's lab or on Dr. Hertz's team to avoid being drafted into the U.S. military for the Korean War. But they were studying choriocarcinoma, in this case gestational choriocarcinoma, a tumor of the placenta. These tumors grow rapidly and metastasize quickly. They often spread to the lungs. So Hertz and Lee knew that their other colleagues had been using antifolates, or methotrexate in this case, and could stop rapidly dividing leukemia cells, if only transiently. At that point, you know, multi-agent chemotherapy had not been developed for leukemia, so they were seeing good responses, but they always relapsed. So they had a young woman with metastatic choriocarcinoma who was in the hospital. She had tumors in her lungs that had caused a pneumohemothorax. She was bleeding so rapidly that the only way they could stabilize her was to retransfuse her own blood. And believe me, this was well before the era of the cell saver. This was some doctors in the middle of the night who said, this lady's going to die if we don't do something. So they decided to give her methotrexate.
Well, since my baby left, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of the
Heartbreak Hotel from 1956. They didn't really expect the patient to survive the night, but when they came in the next morning, she was actually better. Her blood pressure had stabilized, the bleeding had abated to some degree, and they were able to give her four more rounds of chemotherapy. And when they repeated her chest x-ray, expecting maybe the tumors to have shrunk, maybe they were gone. The pulmonary tumors had completely resolved, and her HCG plummeted toward zero. So this was the first cure of a solid cancer with chemotherapy. So the birthplace of medical oncology was actually in gynecologic oncology. Now, interestingly, what happened was that Dr. Lee noticed that in some patients, the HCG, while it fell dramatically, it didn't go to zero. And even though chest x-rays normalized, remember they didn't have CT scans back then, clinical traces of the cancer were gone, but those patients inevitably relapsed. So he decided to just keep treating with this toxic product, the antifolate methotrexate, until the HCG went to zero. The NCI institutional board found out about it and was furious and accused him of experimenting on patients. Isn't that what they were all doing? There were no clinical trials. There were no IRBs. But they accused him of experimenting on patients and continuing to give highly toxic drugs to patients who were supposedly already cured. So he was fired. He went back to Memorial in New York, ultimately to California. He never came back to the NCI. But in the end, he was right. Today, we know that in order to cure trophoblastic disease, including choriocarcinoma, we have to treat past a negative HCG. And generally, it's 3 cycles of chemo past a negative HCG. And today, we cure over 90% of patients with trophoblastic disease. One of the biggest developments of the last 40 years probably has been laparoscopy and minimally invasive surgery. When I was a resident, we were just starting to use laparoscopy. We didn't have video laparoscopy. We had operative laparoscopes that had a viewing channel that you held up to your eye and an operating channel that you could put one instrument in and work with at a time. But over the years, that's developed dramatically, and I just want to review a little bit of that. Here's the impetus for it. This patient has a BMI of 51. She weighs over 300 pounds. And to operate on and her classically would have involved a big midline laparotomy with the long a high risk of perioperative morbidity, infections, tissue exposure was difficult, surgical exposure was difficult. So in 2005, Dr. Tennant already talked about the Da Vinci robot. In 2005, the Da Vinci robot was approved for gynecologic use, and it's really revolutionized the care, particularly of endometrial cancer. Robotic surgery is really now the standard for endometrial cancer. This just shows you the green line in the middle there with the slow, steady increase is gynecology. The orange line with the exponential increase is general surgery. So the general surgeons have really taken over this as well. However, even in 2019, nearly a third of patients still were having open procedures for hysterectomy. This is a video. We'll see if it plays. It should play. There we are. This is a video of a robotic lymphadenectomy. It's about 5 minutes long, so I'm only just going to show a short little clip from it. This just gives you an idea of how the surgery is done. Those are robotic instruments that are mounted on the robotic on the arms of the Da Vinci robot and then controlled from a control panel. And on the right, you can see a picture of the complete lymphadenectomy with the iliac vessels exposed. And one of the things that's really revolutionized endometrial cancer, it The staging was changed to surgical staging, so we have to know the lymph node status in order to define the stage now. And sentinel node mapping was introduced for melanoma, and then it's become very prominent in breast cancer, and now it's kind of the standard of care for endometrial cancer. It has a high detection rate, high sensitivity, and a high negative predictive value. We look for the first lymph node in the chain and then remove it and have that evaluated by the pathologist. It doesn't compromise progression-free survival or overall survival, and then much lower operative complications, shorter hospital stays, and much less risk of lymphedema. These are pictures from the OR at Women and Children's, in a case we did maybe last week, a week or two ago. On the left there, you can see the external iliac artery and vein are being retracted, and then we're looking down into the obturator space, so deep in the pelvis. This is with conventional illumination. We inject indocyanine green or icy green into the cervix prior to starting the procedure. And then when we illuminate with near infrared light, this is what you see. That green, you can on the right at the bottom, you can see a lymphatic leading up to that green blob there. That's what we call the sentinel node, the first node in the chain. And this is the node that's been removed. So minimally invasive surgery is really the standard of care for endometrial cancer at this point. And many of us, including myself, maybe Dr. Christie, I don't know, thought that minimally invasive surgery would be the way to go with cervical cancer. Our thought was, if you can do the same operation through little tiny incisions, then you should have the same clinical outcome and much less morbidity. However, you know, as they say, in God we trust, all others bring data. The LAC trial, laparoscopic approach to cervical cancer, was published in the New England Journal in 2018. It's amazing they were able to actually get this done. It was a randomized trial of minimally invasive versus open abdominal radical hysterectomies. There were over 600 patients. The trial was actually stopped early because of excess deaths in the minimally invasive group. And you can see the disease-free survival at 4 years there was 86% in the minimally invasive group, which admittedly is a little low. We'd expect more like 95%. But in the open group, it was 96.5%. And the overall survival was also lower in the minimally invasive group. You can see there at the bottom, 93.8 versus 99%. These are statistically significant, clinically relevant results. And because of this study, most of the professional societies like the SGO now recommend that radical hysterectomy be performed as an open procedure. And I've changed my practice to do it as an open procedure. Not every doctor believes that. Some doctors think, you know, their data, their patient population, that's not true, but it's hard to argue with a randomized clinical trial with over 600 patients. And those are not subtle differences. You see a greater than a 10%, absolute 10% increase in disease-free survival. This just shows you can see the Kaplan-Meier curve with open versus minimally invasive. And this is overall survival, which shows you the same thing. I'd like to just talk about some recent advances that are really quite exciting in the field of gynecologic oncology. In 2014, the FDA approved a laparib, a PARP inhibitor. As you all know, the patients with BRCA mutations, BRCA1 or BRCA2, besides having an increased risk for breast cancer and prostate cancer, they also have an increased risk for ovarian and fallopian tube cancer. And the BRCA genes are involved in DNA repair, and PARP is an enzyme that's involved with DNA repair. So by inhibiting DNA repair, we get what's called synthetic lethality. And the PARP inhibitors have shown significant prolongation of progression-free survival when used as maintenance in patients with complete or partial response to platinum-based therapy. It's mainly in the BRCA mutated group, but there's also a group of patients that are sort of BRCA-like or BRCA-ish with homologous recombination deficiency due to other reasons besides BRCA mutations, and the PARP inhibitors have shown effectiveness there as well. Then also in 2014, the FDA approved bevacizumab plus chemotherapy for persistent, recurrent, or metastatic. Cervical cancer. The overall survival increased from 12.9 months to 16.8 months. I think I lost some slides here. It was also, bevacizumab was also approved for bevacizumab for plus chemotherapy for ovarian cancer, followed by up to 16 cycles of maintenance bevacizumab. Progression-free survival was about 18 months with the bevacizumab group versus about 12 months with the control group. Now, recently, just in the last year, there have been several important advances. In late 2022, the first antibody drug conjugate for ovarian cancer was approved. It's called mirvetuximab soravtansine, or the commercial name is Elahere. It is an antibody to the folate receptor alpha, which is expressed on about 36% of ovarian cancer patients. This antibody is conjugated to a drug called DM4, which is a mitral tubule disruptor, maybe similar to paclitaxel. But when that antibody binds to the folate alpha receptor on the cell, the drug is internalized and then released, and it damages the microtubular apparatus, results in cell cycle arrest and apoptotic death. Overall response rate was about 32%, and the median overall survival of 16 and a half months in the Elahere arm versus 12.375 months in the control arm. So, you know, doesn't sound like a home run, but this is in platinum resistant ovarian cancer patients. And this was the first new drug that had been introduced for ovarian cancer in the last 10 years, and it gives us an option for patients who typically have been through multiple lines of chemotherapy. What we find is that folate receptor alpha is consistently on tumors that express it doesn't change over time. Sometimes cancers evolve and become resistant to one drug or the other, but the folate receptor alpha expression stays the same. And so if we have a patient who has progressed on multiple arms of chemotherapy, is platinum resistant, there's a reasonable chance that they will respond to the mirvetuximab. And we've certainly seen some dramatic responses in patients who really had little, I mean, the other option was hospice. It does have a unique ocular toxicity. It can affect the cornea, can interfere with vision, but with meticulous attention to the eye care, including eye drops four times a day and slit lamp exams every other treatment. It seems to be manageable. And in our practice, we haven't had a lot of these patients, but we haven't seen any serious ocular toxicity. So it's the first of what I hope will be many antibody drug conjugates for ovarian cancer, because it's a fascinating concept. And lastly, we'll just talk about endometrial cancer. As I said, incidence and mortality continue to rise. It is expected by 2040 to be the third most prevalent cancer and the fourth leading cause of cancer death among women. This is probably primarily related to the obesity epidemic in the world, but particularly in Western civilization. And the mortality is expected to exceed ovarian cancer by next year. It's becoming, we used to classify these tumors just histologically as low grade, high grade, endometrioid versus serous, but it's becoming more and more important to use a molecular classification. And we find that about close to a third of endometrial cancers have high microsatellite instability, indicating deficient mismatch repair. It's now the standard of care for all endometrial cancers to be checked for expression of mismatch repair proteins at the initial pathology report. So we know that for advanced endometrial cancer, monotherapy with an immune checkpoint inhibitor like pembrolizumab or dostarlimab has established efficacy as a second line of therapy in patients with deficient MMR or high microsatellite instability. And we know that pembrolizumab in combination with lenvatinib has shown efficacy in proficient MMR or microsatellite stable endometrial cancer. So this year at the SGO, there were two papers presented on the same day. The titles are listed there at the top: pembrolizumab plus chemotherapy in advanced endometrial cancer and dostarlimab plus chemotherapy in primary recurrent endometrial cancer. They were both presented the same day, and then that afternoon at 5:01 p.m., they were released for online publication in the New England Journal. They were then subsequently presented in print in June of this year in the New England Journal. The references are there at the bottom of the slide. So without going into all the details, they were both randomized phase 3 placebo-controlled trials. And you can see on the left there is the pembrolizumab data. You can see the progression-free survival versus overall survival. And look at the difference in the curves. The odds, the hazard ratio, I think, was 0.2 or 0.3 or 0.28. And notice how the curves flatten off at the end. So, some of these patients who had advanced endometrial cancer may be cured. And we've seen that in our practice. We've seen patients that presented with widespread disease treated in this fashion, and they're, without evidence of disease sometimes a year or two later or longer. On the right side is the dostarlimab data. Again, it shows the same thing, the dramatic improvement in progression-free survival and overall survival. So these studies, you can see the hazard ratios for progression are 0.28 and 0.3, which is amazing. And these studies define a new standard of care for endometrial cancer. So with advanced endometrial cancer, and I should mention that those were in the deficient MMR populations, but there was also an improvement of lesser magnitude in the proficient MMR populations. So going forward, what are the challenges for the future? Well, it's kind of obvious. We need to improve compliance with screening guidelines for cervical cancer. Certainly, there's lots of room for improvement for compliance with vaccine recommendations for HPV. Remember, only 16% of women and 4% of men are vaccinated in the U.S. right now. The vaccine is approved for men and women ages 9 to 45. we need to define the role of minimally invasive surgery, especially for early stage cervical cancer. I think it's pretty clear for endometrial cancer. And we need to figure out, to clarify the role of immunotherapy in gynecologic malignancies. One fascinating question is, can we eliminate cytotoxic chemotherapy in favor of immunotherapy for endometrial cancer, especially in the deficient mismatch repair population? There are ongoing trials right now. And, you know, we'll see. Would that be amazing if we could treat these patients with immunotherapy and not have to make their hair fall out and make them sick to their stomach? And then, you know, as the pandemic made so clear, there are huge disparities in healthcare related to socioeconomic status and race, and there's a lot of work to be done there. I think that's about all I have to say.